أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله الذي علمنا أن نحمد، والصلاة والسلام الأتمين والأكملين على حبيبنا وإمامنا وقرة أعيننا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه الغر الميامين وعلى من اتبع سنته واهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين في أي مكان كانوا وأي زمان عاشوا. اللهم إنا نسألك يا أرحم الراحمين أن تجعلنا منهم والسامعين الحاضرين وسائر المسلمين. اللهم آمين، اللهم آمين، اللهم آمين. Dear respected brothers and sisters, young and elders, today's story is the story of Nabiullah Shu'aib alayhi salam. Shu'aib alayhi salam. Inshallah, we will focus the talk in four main points. Number one, what does the word Shu'aib mean linguistically in Arabic? What can we understand from it? Second, what was the title of Shu'aib alayhi salam among the Anbiya? Third, what was the new social problem comparing to the previous nations that Anbiya Allah were sent? There was a new problem, new social problem that appeared in Madian that Shu'aib alayhi salam was sent to. What was that social problem and how did Shu'aib alayhi salam address it? And the name of Shu'aib alayhi salam is usually mentioned with Madian and Ashabul Aika. Were these two people the same or were they two separate nations? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a tawfiq and the acceptance. رَبِّ اشْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. Shu'aib alayhi salam. Madian was a place near the Red Sea. It was a rich place. It was a stable place. It was a very good place to live. Its people, the people of Madian, were business people. That's their job. And because of the location of Madian, many people used to pass there, especially that location was between Yemen and Syria, and between Egypt and Iraq. So many people passed there, and that place was a stop, a famous stop that many people stopped and they made business. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that He made the people of Madian to become more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ كُنْتُمْ قَلِيلًا فَكَثَّرَكُمْ. And remember that you were little. Here the word little means two things. They were few in number, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala multiplied them, and also they had few richness, not too much richness, you know, not too much business, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought so much business and commerce to them, so they became so rich. So Shu'aib alayhi salam was a very, very respected man in Madian. They used to call him Al-Halim Ar-Rashid. Al-Halim is derived from the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Halim, which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives many chances. He does not destroy immediately. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives many chances for the human being to come back. And if you remember the story of Jeffrey Lang, when he realized that it was the mercy and hilm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that gave his sinner father the chance to come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Halim Ar-Rashid. Ar-Rashid is a wise man. And Rushd also comes from Irshad. He was a wise man with a very good judgment to tell people good nasiha and help them what to do and to solve their problems. Shu'aib comes from the word sha'ib or tash'ib, which means branches. So he was like the person holding intact that city in terms of wisdom, in terms of nasiha, and in terms of islah and good deeds. So the word Shi'aib refers to that. That he was like the trunk of a tree. Many branches are there, but he is holding that society together. He is helping the society to be united, to do good work. What was his title? The ulama of tafsir call him Khatibul Anbiya, the Khatib, the speaker of the Anbiya. And this is based on one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but this hadith is not that strong. Some ulama said it was authentic, others said it was not authentic. But if you look at the speech of Shu'aib alayhi salam, you would really admire his way of answering questions and discussing the matters. So he was indeed Khatibul Anbiya alayhi salam. He was the speaker of Al Anbiya. Madian had so much khair, so good things, you know, they became multiplied in numbers. They became rich. They had strategic place. But unfortunately, they started worshipping other gods beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, in that society, Shu'aib alayhi salam worked on three main problems. Three main ahwal in Madian. Number one, that they worshipped idols beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he always invited them to worship one Allah, one God, Al-Khaliq wa laysa al-makhluq. To worship the creator, not the creation. And notice, in all the stories of Al-Anbiya alayhi salam, this is very important. Why? Because when we talk about Allah, we elevate the iman and the yaqeen of the person, then that will make easier for the person to follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it is very important to work on the imaniyat, to work on the yaqeen. And part of that is to work on the yaqeen of the day of judgment, yawmul akhir. I'm just asking you a question, think about it. How would life appear and how would life be if people came to the conclusion that there was no day of judgment? Wow. And many people, many societies did, and many people still nowadays do. That's why they kill or rob or do all kind of things, because in the back of their minds, there is no day, there is no moment that they will be questioned. So to build the yaqeen is to work always on La ilaha illallah and Al Yawmul Akhir. This was a main theme in the work of the Anbiya alayhim salam. So this was the first ahwal. People worshipping gods beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they did not believe in the last day of judgment. The second ahwal, they used to cheat in business treating. يخسرون الكيل والميزان. When they weigh for people, they cheat, they will this. But when it is their transaction, they do it fully and perfectly, maybe more. So when the business is for them, they make it perfect. They make it complete. They weigh it and they measure it exact or more. But when they are selling to people, when it's the rights of the people, they do less. So this was another main problem that Shu'aib alayhi salam, and if you read the ayat in the Quran, he's constantly talking about that. Every day, constantly, he's reminding them that this is wrong, that this is a big illness, that they had to get rid of that problem. And the third one, because they had a strategic place, they used to interfere with the walking of the people through their territories, unjustly speaking. So they used to stand in the roads cut the roads and force people to do certain things and force them to pay them some taxes or sort of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, He says, وَإِنْ كَانَ أَصْحَابُ الْأَيْكَةِ لَظَالِمِينَ. We have two opinions in the tafsir. The main one that Ashab al-Ayka and Madian are the same thing. The second opinion that Madian and Ashab al-Ayka, there are two different cities, but they were in the same place. They were near each other. And the reason why the Mufassirun said that is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentioned Madian, He says, and to Madian, their brother Shu'aib was sent. But when He mentioned Ashab al-Ayka, He says, and Shu'aib was sent to Ashab al-Ayka. So some Mufassirun sense that Ashab al-Ayka was another city that Shu'aib alayhi salam was sent in addition to Madian. But at the end of the day, both were doing the same thing. Worshipping idols other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, committing injustices against people, and third, cheating in business transactions. So Shu'aib alayhi salam started his da'wah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Ya qawm i'budullah, O my people, the same words of all the prophets, my people. Huh? I am your brother, you are my people. You know, gentleness, softness, kindness. Ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. Worship Allah, there is no God beside Him. وَلَا تَنْقُصُ الْمِكْيَالَ وَالْمِيزَانِ. And do not make less the weight and the business transaction. إِنِّي أَرَاكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ. You are in a very good shape. You have so much khair. You don't have to do it. Why are you not fulfilling and perfecting the measurement of business? إِنِّي أَرَاكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ. There is no reason. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you so much. وَإِنِّي أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ مُحِيطٍ. I am afraid that a punishment that will surround you completely will come upon you because of this. What does this mean? That cheating in business transaction is one of the main reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might punish a people. That's a serious business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Cheating in business. Shu'aib alayhi salam continued, وَيَا قَوْمِ أَوْفُوا الْمِكْيَالَ وَالْمِيزَانِ. Subhanallah. Few ayat, he is repeating the same thing. In the same surah, repeating the same thing. وَيَا قَوْمِ أَوْفُوا الْمِكْيَالَ وَالْمِيزَانِ. Oh my people, complete, perfect the mizan, the scale. وَالْمِكْيَالَ, the business transaction. بِالْقِسْط, by justice. وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. Do not take away from people their rights. Al-Bakhs, the ulama say, is even more broad than a business transaction. Any right for any person becomes a bakhs if the person does not fulfill it. Be it copyright. Copyright. What are the IT brothers? Copyright. Subhanallah. This is a serious business. I'm just trying to give some actual and current examples. Photocopying books without permission. All that is included. You know, the rights of a Muslim. It's included. Not to fulfill the rights of the Muslim. That is bakhs. So when somebody is talking about his right, we usually, human tendency, mashallah, we want it perfect. But when it comes to give those rights, shaitan sometimes steal things from us. So we have to remember the story of Shu'aib, that his main mission, in addition to inviting people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was to warn, do not belittle people their rights. Because when you are doing the business transaction, you are asking for your full right. So when it's your turn, you have to give it perfectly. I remember when I was a young man in Jordan. Subhanallah, I used to love to go to buy from one business shop owner. Because every time he used to sell us, like he is weighing 1 kilogram of sugar, for example, or rice, he would always say, and this is the addition for taqwa. Subhanallah. He would add always, in the Palestinian accent, we call it tatbisha. He makes sure that he gives a little bit more than the actual weight. He doesn't keep it perfect. He says, no, I want to give this. This is for Allah, for taqwa. To make sure that I fulfilled you right. Subhanallah. So these are the kind of things, and this is the mentality that Shu'aib alayhi salam is trying to bring and cultivate and make da'wah to. Then he said, وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. Do not do bakhs. Bakhs is not to fulfill any right whatsoever. وَلَا تَعْثَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُفْسِدِينَ. Do not commit fasad. What is fasad? Fasad is to bring out something that is working well and cause it not to work. That's fasad. Again, fasad. Something is working well. Something is going on, mashallah. Somebody comes and interferes to make it not work. That is fasad and ifsad. وَلَا تَعْثَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُفْسِدِينَ. Do not commit fasad in earth. So Shu'aib alayhi salam, in his da'wah, in summary, he reminded his people by worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remembering the last day of judgment. And we saw anyone who would like to work with da'wah and also tarbiyah, we see the same thing with Luqman alayhi salam and his son. Anyone who's doing da'wah, anyone who's making tarbiyah, it is very, very essential to bring the yaqeen on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day of judgment. This must be done always. If you look at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muhammad in Mecca, same thing was done. Concentration on La ilaha illallah and the last day of judgment. Matter of fact, most of the Quran revealed in Mecca is this. Oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, talking about the last day of judgment, and da'watul anbiya, to learn the example of da'wah and patience. Then, wala tanqusul mikyal. Do not commit any injustices. Do not belittle people, their rights. Fulfill the mikyal, the business, the rights. Then he told them, remember, you are in good shape. Why cheat? So it's like he is telling them, when someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given so much ni'mah, and that person goes out of his way and start cheating, that is even worse than a needy person cheating. We are not giving a license to anyone to cheat, but we are saying that if you compare both of them, somebody whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given huge ni'mah, big ni'mah, and he is cheating, that is worse, because he doesn't need it. He doesn't need it. Yeah. أَوْفُوا الْكَيْلَ وَالْمِيزَانَ بِالْقِسْطِ. And stay away from fasad. And he told them that these things, any society, any community, any ummah that does that, the ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might come upon them. Now let's link this with a famous surah in the Quran that has to do with business transactions and not fulfilling the right in business. Suratul, who knows? Suratul? المطففين فتح الله لك وبارك عليك. Yes, سورة المطففين talks precisely about this. سورة المطففين. ويل للمطففين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الذين إذا اكتالوا على الناس يستوفون وإذا كالوهم أو وزنوهم يخسرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ألا يظن أولئك أنهم مبعوثون ليوم عظيم يوم يقوم الناس لرب العالمين. الله أكبر. Strong آيات. مطففين. طفف يطفف تطفيفا. In Arabic. مطففين. What does it mean? In Arabic people say حصل معه حادث ولكن كانت الجروح طفيفة. What does it mean? The Arabs say, he was involved in an accident, but alhamdulillah, the wounds were tafifa. What does tafifa mean? minor scratches, you know, minor.
So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah is not saying wailun for those who steal millions of dollars. No. He doesn't promise the wail for those who steal huge amounts of money. He says wailun lil mutaffifin. Those who do not fulfill the rights even with the minimum part. The minimum amount. Can you imagine those who fill in the blank? You fill in the blank? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ. A wail for those mutaffifin. Those who do not fulfill the minimum rights. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains their ahwal. He says the same thing. In the story of Shu'aib alayhi salam, he says, "الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ." When the business is for them on the people, yastawfun, from the word istifa or wafa, which is they wanted complete and perfect. Yastawfun, they wanted complete and perfect, not even a hair weightless. You know, hair weightless. They wanted complete and perfect. Now, on the other hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, وَإِذَا كَالُوهُمْ أَوْ وَزَنُوهُمْ. But when it is the right of the people on them, يُخْسِرُونَ. They want them to lose, from the word khasara. يَخْسَرْ خَسَارَ يُخْسِرُونَ. They made them lose. They do not fulfill the rights. So this is indeed serious business. Let me share with you this hadith narrated by Imam Tirmidhi, Imam Ibn Majah, and Shaykh Albani said this is sahih hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to the marketplace. I love the narration of this hadith, and I hope inshallah this would be also an example for my family. This is a hadith narrated by the grandson from his father to the grandfather. So this is beautiful. I love this hadith. Every time I read it, I say, Ya Allah, make my family and all the family of Muslims like that. The grandson narrating from his father and the father from his father. Which means that the grandfather is teaching his son. Yeah, the father is teaching his son and then the grandson. It goes like this. عن إسماعيل ابن عبيد عن أبيه عن جده. Ismail ibn Ubayd narrated from his father and his father from his grandfather. أنه خرج مع الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى المصلى فرأى الناس يتبايعون. The narration is that he came out, the grandfather came out with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم to an area near the masjid, the musalla, and he saw people doing business. فقال, he said, who? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya ma'ashar al-tujjar. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants to catch the attention of the people of the market, those who are doing business. So he said, oh business people, ya ma'ashar al-tujjar, oh you tujjar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is calling, so everyone, what? Looked up and looked at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَرَفَوْا أَعْنَاقَهُمْ وَأَبْصَارَهُمْ فَقَالَ. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the following. إِنَّ التُّجَّارَ يُبْعَثُونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فُجَّارَ إِلَّا مَنِ اتَّقَى وَبَرَّ وَصَدَقَ. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, certainly business people, tujjar, people of tijara, will be sent at the last day of judgment as fujjar, extreme sinners, except those who have three qualities. Number one, man ittaqa, who has taqwa in his business dealings. Wabar, he has birr, he knows how to conduct the business transaction. And the third one, was sadaq, and he is truthful in his dealings. So my dear respected brothers and sisters, young and elders, this is serious business. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the story of Shu'aib alayhi salam some of his beautiful qualities, and all the qualities of the Anbiya alayhi salam were beautiful. Shu'aib alayhi salam, as we mentioned, was Khatibul Anbiya. He had eloquent speech and he was convincing and he had hikmah. But one thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions and emphasizes about Shu'aib, and I'm going to read the ayah, وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ إِلَى مَا أَنْهَاكُمْ إِلَيْهِ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ إِلَى مَا أَنْهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ إِنْ أُرِيدُ إِلَّا الْإِصْلَاحَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُ. This quality of Shu'aib Allah brings out to teach us. He said, I don't want to do the opposite of what I'm telling you. What does that mean? It means a hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari and Muslim through Hadrat Usama ibn Zayd radiyallahu ta'ala an as-sahaba ajma'in. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yu'ta bil-rajuli yawm al-qiyama fayulqa fi an-nar. At the last day of judgment, a person will be brought and he will be thrown in Jahannam, fi an-nar. فَتَنْدَلِقُ أَقْتَابُ بَطْنِهِ فَيَدُورُ بِهَا كَمَا يَدُورُ الْحِمَارُ بِالرَّحَى. Allahu Akbar. So his stomach intestines will come out of his stomach, of his belly, and he will start going around. Rasulullah ﷺ is given the comparison to the Sahaba, just like, you know, the donkey used to go around, أجلكم الله, around, make circles. He's attached to one part of wood or metal to bring water up. Everybody knows what I'm talking about? In the past times, people used to attach an animal to go around to bring water from the wells or do things, you know, on that animal. So Rasulullah ﷺ is given the comparison that a person would be brought to Jahannam. His intestines will come out and he will start going around just like this donkey used to bring water. So people will come to him. فَيَقُولُونَ أَلَمْ تَكُنْ تَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَى عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Man, you used to make أَمْرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, order us to do ma'roof, wa tanha 'an al-munkar, and do nahi 'an al-munkar. What's wrong with you? What are you here? You used to make da'wah. Why are you here? Fayaqulu, he will say, I used to tell you to do good things, but I wouldn't do it. And I used to tell you to abstain from doing bad things, and I used to do it. So my dear respected brothers, this is not to discourage us from doing da'wah. But this is to say that the main thing in da'wah is to work on the da'i himself. And this is a huge part of the rights of people. If the da'iya starts doing exactly the opposite, what is he telling people to do? Then this is a serious, serious problem in dunya and akhirah. And here we have Shu'aib alayhi salam telling. Say, I don't tell you something and I do the opposite. Which tells you that they were trying to push him to do things, you know, that he used to tell them that they were wrong. Another quality about Shu'aib alayhi salam, he used to do salah a lot. Everybody used to notice his salah. The scholars say maybe it's beauty, maybe it's length, maybe he used to do it as da'wah outside. All these meanings are included. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the people of Shu'aib said, قَالُوا يَا شُعَيْبُ أَصَلَاتُكَ تَأْمُرُكَ أَن نَتْرُكَ مَا كَانَ يَعْبُدُ آبَاؤُنَا أَوْ أَن نَفْعَلَ فِي أَمْوَالِنَا مَا نَشَاءَ. Oh, you Shu'aib, your salah, this salah that you are showing us, does it order you, your salah, does it order you to tell us not to worship what our fathers used to worship, and you are saying that we cannot do anything we want in our money? This is our money, this is our freedom. You are telling us that we cannot do anything we want in our money? إِنَّكَ لَأَنْتَ الْحَلِيمُ الرَّشِيدُ. You are the person of hilm and wisdom and rushud. You tell people what to do, right from wrong. Another quality that Shu'aib alayhi salam had was deep tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He used to say, وَمَا تَوْفِيقِي إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. There is no tawfiq, there is no success except in Allah. A beautiful word on the tongue of a Nabi Kareem, Shu'aib alayhi salam. My dear respected brothers and sisters, young and elders, there is no tawfiq except in Allah. Nothing will work, nothing will happen except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why we have to do things correctly. And we have to follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the orders of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that Shu'aib alayhi salam was given a sign, a miracle, but he did not specify what kind of miracle it was. We know he was given a miracle. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam also mentioned, and the hadith is in Sahih Bukhari, that no prophet was sent to his people except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would aid him with a miracle, a mu'jiza. So every prophet was given a mu'jiza or several mu'jizat. So Allah mentioned that Shu'aib had a sign, but we don't know what was his sign, what was his mu'jiza. Shu'aib alayhi salam, reminding his people, he said, Inni lakum rasulun amin. I am a trustworthy Nabi for you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said the famous statement of Al-Anbiya, that we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq, inshallah, to reach that level. All the Anbiya said the same statement. وَمَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ إِنْ أَجْرِيَ إِلَّا عَلَىٰ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I do not ask you for any reward for it. My reward is on Allah, the Lord of the worlds. And he reminded them, as I said, اعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره. Worship Allah, you don't have any God beside him. And then he reminded them to be conscious and mindful of the day of judgment. اعبدوا الله وارجوا اليوم الآخر. Remember, be conscious, be mindful of the last day of judgment. And the same statement of Nuh and the Anbiya before him, he said, وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ ثُمَّ تُوبُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّ رَبِّي رَحِيمٌ وَدُودٌ. Make istighfar and tawbah. And he is encouraging them to do so. And he mentions two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rahim, the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he mentioned the name Al-Wadud. Notice that in the Arabic language, the word hub means love. But there is no name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Al-Habib. Allah is Al-Wadud, which is beyond Al-Habib. Al-Wadud is defined as the one who starts the relationship of love and demonstrates it with actions and sayings. This is Al-Wadud. The one who starts, he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, initiates the relationship of love with his servants. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demonstrates that with his bounties and actions and with what he said in the Quran and with the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then Shu'aib alayhi salam gave a beautiful reminder. He said, بَقِيَّةُ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. What does the word baqiyya mean? Baqiyya means to remain. بَقِيَّةُ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ, which means any good deed will remain in this life and in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Is there any reward for excellent job and excellent deed except excellent reward? هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward good deed always. So he's reminding them, Baqiyatullah, which means the good deed will remain. Life will go away. Name will go away. Fame will go away. Everything will go away. We are going to go away and die. Not only that, Allah mentions in the Quran, and the scientists also confirm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the universe is going to go away. The whole universe, not just insan, the whole universe is going to vanish and go away. كَمَا بَدَأْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ نُعِيدُ. Just like we started the creation, we will bring it back to the same point Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. Baqiyatullahi khayrun lakum, said Shu'aib alayhi salam. But just like we saw with the other Anbiya, people were split in two halves. Those who believed in Shu'aib alayhi salam and those who didn't. And those who didn't started belying Shu'aib, exactly the same formula. It starts with one level and they keep escalating and bringing that up and up and up. They start with few words, then they do and plan for something else. So let's look. The first thing they said to Shu'aib, you are Al-Halim Al-Rashid. Shu'aib, come on now, stop doing this. Stop your da'wah, stop your effort. You are Rashid and Halim, Halim and Rashid. You have the quality of Hilm, patience, given chance, and Rashid. You are wise and you tell people the correct judgment. So this was the first thing, talking to him in good words. Then he continued the da'wah. So they said, قَالُوا يَا شُعَيْبُ لَا نَفْقَهُ كَثِيرًا مِمَّا تَقُولُ. You know, we don't understand your speech. We don't understand you. We just don't understand or comprehend what you are talking about. Then they said, وَإِنَّا لَنَرَاكَ فِينَا ضَعِيفًا. And this is another step now. You know, you are a weak man here. You are a weak man. وَإِنَّا لَنَرَاكَ فِينَا ضَعِيفًا. You are a weak man. Be careful. We can harm you. وَلَوْلَا رَهْتُكَ لَرَجَمْنَاكَ. And if it was not for your rahat, we would stone you. What does the word rahat mean? Rahat is a small group of people. And what comes to mind, the hadith narrated by Imam Bukhari at the last day of judgment, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be standing at the hawd, basil of water, right? Hawdul Kawthar. So people will come to him. So the angels will stop some. فيقول النبي أصحابي my أصحاب my صحابة فيقال إنك لا تدري ما أحدث بعدك. It will be said, you don't know what they have changed after you. So some people try to use this hadith to make bid'ah and talk about the Sahaba, you know. But alhamdulillah, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم gave the word rahat in that hadith. Why is that word important? Because the word rahat means very few people. Which means, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made shahada for the sahaba in the Quran, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is making shahada in this sahih hadith, that only few of those people who were around him from the sahaba changed after him. But the majority were the great Sahaba. They fulfilled the mission and they continued the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they are telling Shu'aib, وَلَوْلَا رَحْتُكْ. If it was not for your rahat, we would stone you. But now one might think, rahat is a small group. Why didn't they stone him? Because this rahat and Shu'aib alaihi salam, they were wise people. People used to love them, used to like them. They used to help people. So that's why they could not stone Shu'aib alayhi salam, although his people were few. But they are reminding him, you are weak, be careful. What did he answer? Beautiful answer. from a beautiful Prophet of Allah alayhi salam wa ala al-anbiya wal mursalin jami'an. He said, arahti a'azzu alaykum min Allah, my raht have more value in your eyes than Allah, which means anyone who thinks that anyone is weak in the society and because of his people he is not going to do harm to that person, he should think about the right of Allah first, because otherwise he is being just like the people of Shu'aib. If someone says, I'm not going to harm someone or do bad things to someone because people might think bad of me, the person who's doing the bad thing, or because of his people, he is making karama for makhluq above than the karama of the Khaliq. And that's what the people of Shu'aib were doing. And that was his beautiful answer, Khatib al-Anbiya, the speaker of the Anbiya. Arahti a'azzu alaykum min Allah, you don't want to harm me because of my people, but you are not given Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the izzah and the karama? What's wrong with you people? That is a serious business that people have to think about. Then they said, قال الملأ الذين استكبروا من قومه لنخرجنك يا شعيب والذين آمنوا معك من قريتنا أو لتعودن في ملتنا. The Mala. Who are the Mala? The high level people. It comes from the word Mal'an. What does the word Mal'an mean? Full. So they are full of power, full of money, full of prestige, full, whatever. And this word Mala is not necessarily a bad word. If it is used with good words, with good people, then it becomes good. If it is used with bad people, it becomes bad. Sulaiman alayhi salam. قال يا أيها الملأ أيكم يأتيني بعرشها قبل أن يأتوني مسلمين. So Sulaiman عليه السلام said, oh my ملأ, the ملأ of Sulaiman were good people. But the ملأ of the people of Shu'aib, the high status people, they were not good people because they used to do ifsad. قالوا يا شعيب لنخرجنك من أرضنا. Now we are planning and we are going to kick you away. We are going to kick you out of our town, out of our qarya. Or, لَتَعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. The other option you have, you come back to our millah, to our deen. So the ulama stopped here and said, لَتَعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. Our aqidah says that al-anbiya'u ma'sumuna min ash-shirki qabla ar-risala wa qabla an-nubuwah. Hadha 'indana fil aqidah. All our ulama in the aqidah confirm that the anbiya and the mursaleen are protected from shirk even before nubuwah and risala. That's our aqidah. No nabi has committed shirk even before he became the nabi of Allah or Rasulullah. So when they are saying, come back, the wording in Arabic might suggest in the head of some people that Shu'aib was a mushrik like them and he is now being asked to go back. But here we have to pay attention to the preposition. عاد إلى ما كان عليه. عاد من المكان. وعاد في بمعنى دخل فيه. So they are saying, لَتُعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا ليس إلى ملتنا, which suggests that the wording in Arabic, although the word عاد يعود, which means to return, is used, but the preposition في suggests that they are inviting him to do something new. It doesn't suggest whatsoever that Shu'aib عليه السلام was a mushrik or kafir. قال, he said, أولو كنا كارهين, we don't want to do this and we cannot do this. If we do this, افترينا على الله كذبا, we would be committing the biggest lie on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he makes tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his name Al-Fattah.
ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وأنت خير الفاتحين. الفتاح, the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means and suggests that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the ability and the power to open any closed door or any closed situation. So Shu'aib alayhi salam is reaching the conclusion that his people are making it difficult for him, for the believers, and themselves. So he's telling them, I cannot commit shirk. And right now, since you are asking me this, I am putting everything in the hand of Al-Fattah. Oh Allah, open the closed doors between my people and myself. After that, they started the personal attack. قالوا إنما أنت من المسحرين. You know, Shu'aib, you are under the influence of magic. وما أنت إلا بشر مثلنا. You are just a human being, just like us. وإن ظنك لمن الكاذبين. Beyond, we believe that you are a liar. Subhanallah. But things got worse. They are challenging Shu'aib, and therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the worst thing that they have done. قالوا, they said, فَأَسْقِطْ عَلَيْنَا كِسَفًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ. You know, bring sa'iqa or harm to us or things from the sky, like sparks or lightning. Bring that from the sky unto us if you are saying the truth. If you are a truthful sadiq, then bring the punishment from the sky on us. So when they challenged him, unfortunately, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them so much chance. Allah knew their hearts. Allah knew that they understood that Shu'aib alayhi salam was the messenger of Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the punishment that they asked for. What did they ask for? Something from the sky, like a spark or like the pieces of the volcano, something like that, you know, comes from the sky. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى فكذبوه. They belied Shu'aib. فأخذهم عذاب يوم الظلة. So the punishment of the day of the shadow. What does it mean? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent in the sky the like of clouds, and He sparked them with all kind of punishment. Not only that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَكَذَّبُوهُ فَأَخَذَتْهُمُ الرَّجْفَ. They belied him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also sent on them al-rajfa, which is the shaking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shook them, just like He shook the people of Thamud before them. Rajfa. The ulama say it could be one of two or both of them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused their bodies to shiver in a way that they became, you know, punished in a very harsh way. Or that the earth underneath was shivering and shaking with them. And some ulama say it was both. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, وَأَخَذَتِ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا الصَّيْحَةِ. The scream, صَيْحَة, which is the very high frequency sound or voice. Could be the voice of an angel or a voice of one of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayha, scream, very high frequency, in a way that they would be destroyed internally because of that extreme high frequency sound. So sayha, rajfa, and azabu yawm al-dhulla. And I would finish with the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comparing
the people of Madian, the people of Shu'aib alayhi salam, with the people of Thamud. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى كأن لم يغنوا فيها. If you look at them, it's like they never had any wealth or richness, which means that Allah has given them what? So much wealth and so much richness. كأن لم يغنوا فيها ألا بعدا لمدين كما بعدت ثمود. Indeed, Madian was casted away, meaning out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, into his punishment, just like Thamud was casted away from his mercy into his punishment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq to act upon the lessons that we heard, and inshaAllah make da'wah for it. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.